When I was in Papua New Guinea last year, a man named Job painted this chart for me. This is Revelation where?
17.
17. The mother of harlots herself. And he painted three other charts for me. And I've been setting these up in China and Taiwan and Philippines. And this is a good way to get people's attention. You set it up on the street or in a park somewhere, and people wonder, what in the world is that? Now, in China, I don't know if you've had much contact with Chinese people, but about between 1/4 and 1/5 of the whole planet are Chinese. There's a lot of Chinese in our world. In Isaiah 49, verse 12, it says, many will come from afar, and many from the north and the west, and many from the land of Sinim, which is the land of China. I have my Chinese Bible right here, and in that Isaiah 49, 12 in the Chinese Bible says, 这是从远方来,这是从西方从北方来,这是从秦国来. Qinguo means the land of Sinim. And I've asked many Chinese on trains, on buses, on airplanes, what does this mean, Qinguo? And they said, well, yes, that's the old name of our country, of China. It was the name of China in the time when Qin Shi Huang was making the Great Wall of China. And Isaiah was written about 700 BC. So this was a prophecy that at the end of time, many people would come from the land of Sinim. And Jesus' invitation is, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And the last gospel invitation in the whole Bible is, the Spirit and the bride say what?
Come.
And he that heareth saith what?
Come.
And whosoever will, let him come and take the water of life freely. So there's a prophecy in the Bible. The Bible talks about our great country of America. It talks about Russia in Colossians 3:11. It talks about Italy. It talks about Spain and India in Esther. And of course, 1/4 or 1/5 of the planet, it would mention about China. So it says many will come from the land of China. But I don't know if we could do this. Are certain nationalities have sort of a trait? Like, for example, Missouri. What are people are from Missouri known for?
Show me state.
A show me state, okay? And certain countries are maybe this or that, but Chinese people are very curious. And, you know, the saying, curiosity killed the cat. Well, curiosity can be good or bad, but Chinese people are, for the most part, quite curious. And when I set up this chart in China somewhere, and then as a foreigner talking to them in Chinese, they're just as curious can be. And they come around and gather around by the dozens, and then it gets up to the hundreds, and they wonder, what in the world is that? And just a few months ago in China, I was on an island and put this chart up, and a young policeman came. Maybe tomorrow I can get it and let you listen. A young policeman came, and he could speak English a little bit, and so I talked with him in English and Chinese mixed up a bit, and he said, I want to tell you something. And he sort of got red in the face and a little bit nervous, and I said, it's okay. And then he began to quote to me about a two-minute segment or excerpt from President Obama's inaugural address, verbatim. He had the tone and the accent of President Obama, and he quoted this little thing. I forget what it was, but it was something from Obama's speech. So I listened and said, well, that's good. And I said, but I can give you something better to memorize. And so I wrote down a little prayer from Christ Object Lessons. Lord, take my heart. I cannot give it. Keep my heart pure. I can't keep it pure for thee. Mold me and fashion me after your likeness and raise me up into heaven's atmosphere. So I wrote it down. My writing must have been a little bit like Ellen White's writing. It's a little bit messy or something. Anyway, he sent me back a email, and he memorized this speech, and he was trying to think of Obama with the emphasis and expression on certain words, and I'll let you listen. You'll smile, I'm sure. He has a Chinese accent, and he misses up on a few words, and he puts the stress on certain syllables. But it just thrills my soul to see these communist, atheist, socialist Chinese people memorizing God's word and doing things like that. But God is opening up amazing doors in China, and he's a policeman, as a matter of fact. And we'd set up this chart on the beach. He'd help me put it up on the thing here, and then other policemen would come by to listen, because technically it's not allowed for foreigners to come into China and preach the gospel. It's illegal. Many have been fined, put in prison. But when the policeman came by, I switched from talking about Revelation 17 or the Bible to talking about smoking and drinking. When we saw the policeman coming, I'd talk about alcohol and tobacco. And they'd listen for a while, and then they'd go away, and then we'd switch back to the parable of the lost sheep. Oh, they love to hear. The Chinese people love to hear the parable about the lost sheep. And I told them how that the one lost sheep represents what?
This earth.
Primarily, it has a double significance. Secondarily, it means you and you and you, all of us. But primarily, it means this earth. And then what would the 99 other sheep represent? The other worlds in the universe. And all these Chinese people, when they're listening about other worlds in the universe, and then we'd switch from that to this woman, and they said, "Who is this?" And then we'd talk about tobacco and alcohol. And anyway, God is opening doors. In Colossians, I think it says something about a door of utterance and opening doors to spread the gospel here and there. And I had another set of little slides I want to show you in a minute. But before that, let's look in our Bibles. You brought your Bibles together. Matthew 22. Matthew 22. The Bible tells us that without a parable, Jesus never spoke. Matthew 22. So let's follow Jesus' example a little bit here today and look at a parable. Matthew 22 and verse 1. Jesus answered and spake unto them again by parables. Another place it says he never spoke without a parable. So here he's speaking again by parables. And he said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a certain king which made a marriage for his son." Now, just for the sake of the gospel, let's just say that this king is the blessed and only potentate, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, okay? And let's just say for the sake of the everlasting gospel that his son is his only begotten son. Now, what happened? "He sent forth his servants to call them that were bidden to the wedding, and what did they do?
They wouldn't come.
Now remember, we just listened that Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest." The last gospel in the last book, last chapter, almost the last verse, it says, "The Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him that heareth say, come." And come, come, come. The Isaiah prophecy about China says, many will come from afar. Many will come from the north and the west and from the land of Sinim. But it says these wouldn't come. Okay, now, verse 4. "Again he sent forth other servants, saying, tell them which are bidden, behold, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fatlings are killed, and all things are ready. Come unto the marriage." Now, in this one, just for the sake of vegetarianism, let's say my oatmeal and walnut entree is ready, and my red as scarlet peppers are sliced, and everything is ready, so come. Now what happened? Verse 5, "But they made light of it and went their ways, one to his farm," probably an organic farm, "another to his merchandise." Okay? "And the remnant," have you ever heard of the remnant? "Which keep the commandments of God and have what? Testimony of Jesus." And the testimony of Jesus, Dorothy, is what? Spirit of prophecy. Okay, or the other way around is maybe we should probably say the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. It mentions it that way more than the spirit of prophecy just once, but testimony of Jesus many times. Okay, the remnant are in there, keeping the commandments of God. And the remnant took his servants and entreated them spitefully and slew them. But when the king heard thereof, he was wroth. And he sent forth his armies and destroyed those murderers and burned up their city. Then saith he to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which were bidden were not what?
Worthy.
Are any of us worthy?
No.
What does the Bible say? Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing is in the Lamb, not in us. What did the man say? I'm not worthy for you to what?
Come under
my roof, but what? Speak the word only, and my servant will be healed. So these ones here were not worthy, and then what happened? Go ye therefore into the highways, and as many as you find, bid them to the marriage. So those servants went out unto the highways and gathered together all as many as they found, both what? Bad and good. And the wedding was furnished with guests. Now, how many of you here today are bad? How many of you are good?
Only
one good, that's God. The only good one is Jesus. Okay, that would have to make Jesus to be God too then. Fit in there somehow, right? But a lot of you weren't neither good or bad, according to the hands here. Okay, anyway, whether they're good or bad, it says they were all invited in. Now let's look what happened in verse 10. So those servants went out into the highways, gathered all the people, both bad and good, and the wedding was furnished with guests. Now, verse 11 is coming down to the time where it's in the perfection of character time. First there's the invitation, then now verse 11. When the king came in to see the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment. And he saith unto him, Friend, how camest thou in hither, not having a wedding garment? And he was what?
Speechless.
Then said the king to his servants, Bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but how many are chosen?
Few
are chosen. Now, with that in mind, let's look in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And we'll remember the bad and the good here for a moment. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And verse 4. Second Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 4. If he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom you have not preached, or if you receive another spirit, whom you have not received, or another gospel which you have not accepted, another gospel which you have not accepted, ye might well bear with him. So we have three anothers in there. What are they? Another Jesus. Are there another Jesuses being preached today?
Yes.
Yeah. Another Jesus, another spirit, and another gospel. Now, is another Jesus bad or good?
Bad.
Okay. What did the angel say to the men of Galilee? Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This what? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner, as you've seen him go into heaven. So we're not talking about a different Jesus, another Jesus, but the same Jesus that sweat blood in Gethsemane, that the blood flowed from his side, the same one that said, come unto me, and the same one that resurrected and said, I am the resurrection and the life. And then he ascended up, and now he's our great high priest, and soon he's coming again. Okay, not another Jesus. How about another gospel? Is that good or bad?
Bad.
In Galatians it says, if someone comes and preaches another gospel, let him be what?
Cursed.
And it says, even if an angel comes, let him be accursed. How about another spirit, good or bad? Are there other spirits being floating around today? Another spirit, good or bad? Okay, let's look now in Numbers, the book of Numbers. Book of Numbers, chapter 14. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. And Numbers, chapter 14. Well, first of all, let's look in chapter 13. Numbers, chapter 13, and verse 30. Numbers, chapter 13, and verse 30. The brother the other night said that courage and hope and sympathy and faith and love promote health and prolong life. And if there's anyone in the Bible that is a man that we could say has courage, it would be Caleb here. Let's look what Caleb said in verse 30. Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up, what?
At once
and possess it. For maybe we can overcome it. Is that what he said?
We are well able.
Now, unto, what does the Bible say? Now unto him that is what? Able to what? Keep you from falling. We are well able to overcome it. And they look like grasshoppers amongst themselves. But now look in chapter 14. Chapter 14 and verse 7. And they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we possess, which we pass through to search it, is what kind of a land? Exceeding good land. You know, if we could see heaven, if we could see the glories of the New Jerusalem, like the song says, the things of this earth will what? Grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. If we could see the New Jerusalem and those gates of pearl and our harps and our crowns and the tree of life, it's an exceeding good land. Now, verse 8. If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. If the Lord delight in us. Now, we may say, well, the Lord may delight in them, but I know he doesn't delight in me. My heart's deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. How could the Lord ever delight in me? But if Jesus is our Savior, if we've accepted him as our Savior and opened the door of our heart and invited him in, it says, if he delighteth in us. What did God say about his Son? This is my beloved Son in whom I am what?
Well
pleased. The Son that I delight in whom I'm well pleased. Now, you told me that another Jesus is bad. You told me that another gospel is bad. And you also told me that another spirit is bad. Now let's look in Numbers 24 and verse 24. Numbers 14, verse 24. But my spirit Caleb, my servant Caleb, because he had what?
Another
spirit with him, and hath followed me what? Fully. Him will I bring into the land whereunto he went, and his seed shall possess it. Now, did Caleb have another spirit?
No, he had the right spirit.
Did he have is this another spirit good or bad?
Good.
Good, yeah. This is the kind of another spirit that we need.
Spirit of the Lord.
Spirit of the Lord, yes. And Ellen White says, let the Calebs that have another spirit come to the front now. This is no time for us at the end of the world to be like the 10 spies that said, oh, that were fearful and said, oh, we're like grasshoppers and they're like giants. But today is the time to be like Caleb and Joshua, to have that another spirit, to be filled with, what does the Bible say? Do not be drunk with wine, but what? But filled with the Spirit. And Jesus said, the words I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. And Ellen White says, there are Enochs today. They're modern-day Enochs. God wants to train each one of us to walk with him like Noah did, like Enoch did, and to become a modern-day Enoch.
Amen.
And pray without what? Daniel prayed 3 times a day. We were talking in our young adult class yesterday about noon prayer. Sometimes it's easier for us to neglect the noon prayer. That was the secret of Daniel's life. He had that special time three times a day. Even though the law was made that nobody can pray for 30 days, Daniel still prayed. Those were those secret special times to get connected. That's not the pray without ceasing time when you're driving down the road and cooking and taking a shower. We can learn how to pray all through the day with our eyes open. But these were special times. And so Caleb had another spirit. And think of the promise that God gives us. Even though you are evil and you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give? It was a ten-time punch. Ask and it will be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you three times. Everyone that asketh receiveth four. Everyone that seeketh findeth five. Everyone that knocketh it shall be opened six. If a son asks bread, will he give him a stone? Seven. If he asks for a fish, will he give him a snake? Eight. If he asks for an egg, will he give him a scorpion? Nine. And then to top it off, God says, if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father pour out his spirit upon those that ask him? With that kind of a 10-finger, 10-toe, 10-point invitation, ask and it will be given you. We ought not to... The reason that we're not filled with the Holy Spirit surely ought not to be because we're not asking. Remember that verse in James says, you have not because what?
Yes.
You ask not. And so God wants to fill us with his Spirit. And the Bible says in the book of Daniel, the people that do know their God will what? Will be strong and do exploits. There's a principle, you can look it up in the spirit of prophecy, talking about cause and effect. Let's look in Proverbs, cause and effect. Proverbs 30, we could probably go around the world, the room here today, and everybody can give an example. Why don't somebody think of one, and we'll look at this first, and then someone else can throw out a cause and effect. Look at the last verse of Proverbs 30. The last verse of Proverbs 30, and it says, surely the churning of milk bringeth forth what? Butter. So what is the cause and what is the effect here?
Churning
the milk is the cause, and then it turns into butter. That's the effect. Now the next one, the ringing of the nose bringeth forth blood. So ringing your nose, punching someone in the nose or something, the blood will come out. Everything has a cause and effect. Someone just share some kind of cause and effect you can think of. You smoke cigarettes? The effect may be you get lung cancer. Should someone that smokes cigarettes blame God for the lung cancer? No. When you plant corn, you'll get corn. What is it? Okay, Andy?
You jump off the roof, you're going to get hurt.
Jump off the roof, you're going to get hurt. Or you fall off the roof, Linford, you're going to get hurt. Okay. There's many examples of cause and effect, right? In the book Desire of Ages, it says in the connection of perfection of character, it says in there that when we know God, as it is our privilege to know him, then our life will be a life of continual obedience. So what is the cause?
Knowing God.
And then the effect will be continual obedience. That statement goes on to says, through an appreciation of the character of Christ, through communion with God, sin will what? Become hateful to us. I heard of somebody that took a big goblet and passed it around the room and asked for everybody to spit in it. And then it came back and then he drank it. Doesn't that sound terrible? Would that be a strong temptation for you to avoid doing that? No, because that's just hateful to us to think about it. But there's other temptations that aren't hateful to us and sort of charming and draw us, and we fall into it now and then. But that cause and effect principle says, through an appreciation of the character of Christ and through communion with God, sin can become hateful to us.
Rather die than sin.
But if we focus on the effect rather than on the cause, that's not, we need to go to the right. So that verse in Daniel says, the people that know their God, they'll be strong and do exploits. So if, say, a pastor of a church, he's got, let's say, 30 church members, maybe about as many as are here today. And let's say the church members are weak, and maybe even a little bit of the curse of Meroz is upon them. You remember the curse of Meroz?
Do nothings.
Do nothings. Do not come up to the help of the Lord. And remember, Ellen White says, when there is no active service for others, our love wanes and our faith grows dim. Now, active service for others can be anything from making phone calls and witnessing through email, going house to house, sharing literature, praying, here am I, send me, God may send you, who knows where he'll send you, and by praying for others, intercessory prayer. And there's many ways, but we need to all get involved in some kind of active work. And that, Ellen White says that God could have finished the work through the angels. The angels could have spread the gospel around the world in a few days or weeks, but for our blessing, so that we can get a blessing and we can help prepare our characters, God's given us a part to do. So he said, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. I have fun sometimes going into different countries, and you know, when you go into another country, they give you a little paper, immigration paper, and you have to write down your name and your age and passport number, and then they have a thing for occupation. Sometimes I write in there, fisherman. And sometimes I'll have a tie, and they look, you don't look like a fisherman. But aren't we all, our first job is fishers of men. Amen. And then secondarily, you know, we may be carpenters or doctors or farmers, whatever else, but all God, Jesus said, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. And for Jesus to say so many times, follow me, that tells me that he had a nature like our nature. He had the seed of Abraham, the seed of David. For him to say, follow me, follow me, follow me so much, and then to have some great advantage over us, that doesn't really make sense. That's almost like I used to sneak carrots out of the refrigerator when my mom wasn't looking and feed them to our horses. And I'd wave the carrot out, and the horse would come in the field right over to the barbed wire fence, and I'd sort of put that carrot up there. I'd like to look at their teeth. Horses' teeth are always so straight and nice, and they got those big lips, you know, and I'd put the carrot out there, and he'd try to get it, but I was tantalizing and sort of teasing the horse for a while, but then finally I'd give the carrot to him. But is God doing that to us when he says, to him that overcometh? Seven times, to him that overcometh, but Caleb just told us we are well able to go up and possess it at once. And so Jesus said, to him that overcometh, even as I overcame. The Laodicean church. To him that overcometh, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame. Did Jesus have to overcome something?
Yes.
What did Jesus overcome?
World.
What does the Bible say Jesus overcame?
The world.
He tells us in the Bible, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth. And then he said, in the world you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have what?
Overcome
the world. He overcame the world. And the world was what? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. When he prayed, not my will, but thy will. Not my will, but thy will be done. We can see the struggle that was going on in Jesus' heart. But anyway, I want to just, in from Proverbs here, it says, cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country. And let's see what happened to this thing. When you pray three times a day like Daniel, I want to give you a little bit of subject matter for prayer. And, I pressed the wrong button again. How do I get...
Press the forward button.
Okay, here we go. Now, this is in Ma'anshan, China. This is the communist flag up here. Five stars, four small stars, and one big star. The four small stars stand for the peasants, the farmers, the factory workers, the military, and the students. And then the big star over here, it's not, oh, that doesn't work on this thing. Okay. Anyway, the big star here represents communism and the Chinese government that way. This brother here, Brother Chun, is a Chinese brother that has accepted the Godhead message about that there's one God and one mediator between God and man. And this brother Yao here also has accepted the message. China is opening up little flocks here and there of men and women. And we got invited. This is a Sunday church that we got invited to speak at. And we were just there a couple of months ago, and they listened all day. They gave us the time to preach on Sunday and bought books later on and took tracts. God is just opening incredible doors. A couple years ago, I was there. We met a female pastor, went into a little place to talk and told her about the Sabbath. And then she accepted the truth about the Sabbath, went back to her church, about 25 church members, and told them all about the Sabbath. They all keep the Sabbath now. Then we went back later, and they moved to another place, but they don't know about the spirit of prophecy. They all know about the Sabbath. So I went there and presented a little sermon about prophetesses, female prophets, right? Prophetess. And we went through the prophetesses in the Bible, starting with Miriam. And then, first of all, we started with how Jesus said, take heed and beware of false prophets. If Jesus wanted us to beware of all prophets, he would have just said, beware of prophets. But he said, beware of false prophets. So that means that there could be true prophets. Anyway, we went through Miriam and Huldah and Deborah. And then I told them how that Ellen White also was a prophetess. And we gave them the book Steps to Christ. You should have seen the looks on their faces as we verified from the Bible about Huldah, about Deborah, about Miriam, about Noah. There's another false prophet. Jezebel is a false prophetess. And there's another false prophetess in the book of Nehemiah, Noah Dyer or something. I forget her name. And anyway, there was 11 altogether. But then I said, now, you know, this book is written by a modern-day prophetess. And we went around and read from the book Steps to Christ, and their faces lighted up. They were so happy to get that book. And God is opening incredible doors there in China. Look at this Buddhist temple with three Buddhas. Three Buddhas in there. And it says it's an easy to make an idol of a false doctrine and theories as to fashion an idol of wood or stone. By misrepresenting the attributes of God, Satan leads men to conceive of him in a false character. With many, a philosophical idol is enthroned in the place of Jehovah, while the living God, as he is revealed in his word, in Christ, and in the works of creation, is worshipped by few. So many Buddhist temples in China, in Korea and China, have three Buddhas. So this concept of three is not only in Christianity with the false teaching of the Trinity, but in other religions too. It goes way back. This is a church in Taizhou. We went there, and they also, in Seventh-day Adventist Church, asked us to speak. We were there the whole Sabbath. And right before we were here, this is the Ten Commandments in the back here. It lights up at night. And before we were here, we were in a city, and the name of the city was Nine Rivers. Zhejiang, China. Zhou means nine, and Jiang means rivers, Zhejiang. So just for the sake of a place to begin, I asked them, how many of you here today believe that there are nine gods? Because I've just been in nine rivers, so I said, we'll start with number nine. How many of you think there's nine gods? Nobody raised their hand. How many of you think there's seven gods? We're going with the odd numbers. Mm-hmm. Nobody raised their hand with seven gods. How many of you think there's five gods? Nobody raised their hand on five gods. How many of you think there's three gods? And half of the church raised their hands. And then I said, how many of you think there's one God? And the other half raised their hands. So I said, well, now look at brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen. Half of you think there's three gods. Half of you think there's one God. We got to figure this out here. And so we went through the Bible and read the many verses that says there's one God, one God. Then we went through again. How many of you think there is nine gods, seven gods, five gods? Nobody. How many of you think there's three gods? Second time through, nobody. How many think there's one God? Then they all raise their hand.
Amen.
And there's been a little bit of agitation. Remember, Ellen White says, agitate, agitate, agitate. And there's some agitation going on. Then we were in the Philippines. Also before that, this is Papua New Guinea. We had a big camp meeting there, having some meetings at night. You can see all the people. There was probably about 300-400 on Sabbath, maybe 600-700. And it was about a four-day meeting. The electricity went out. We had to come. The generators went out even. And then we had to come in this building. And these folks over there, these are some of the other charts. You can see this chart here almost looks like this, the Mother of Harlots up here. Maybe it's sort of the same one. But they have all these charts. They set them up, and people come and listen, not by the dozens or hundreds, sometimes 300-500. And here you can see all the people they invited. First, one of the local Papua New Guinea brothers came, and then I went up and spoke. There's probably 200-300 here, and you should see the looks on their faces. They stand up for a while and listen. Then they sit down and listen, young children, women, and eager to hear about the Word of God. And some people come up later on and they gave me a bottle of water to drink. Someone came up and gave me an orange. Some guy came up and shook my hands, and there was 4 kina. Kina is their money, like dollars, you know. It was about 30 cents or something. They have paper money that's real small, and it was hardly anything, but he wanted to just show his appreciation for somebody coming and sharing the gospel there. And you can see the people gathering around. If you look in the background, this thing doesn't work on here, but you can see the pigs over here. Mommy pig, there's some big ones, and little ones, and garbage. This was near the marketplace, and these Papua New Guinea brothers and sisters were listening and listening for hours. And it started to rain, and some of them didn't have umbrellas standing there. You can see some of them with umbrellas, some of them didn't. It started to rain, and they'd listen and listen and listen more and more and more and come and go. And I had my Papua New Guinea Bible there. It's pidgin. I'll tell you the part of the Lord's Prayer. Papa belong me pella, you stop long. Number 3 heaven name belong you. He must be holy. Huh. It's sort of a combination of English and German and another thing. And see you later is looking you behind. They put I am on all the verbs. So eat him, drink him, look him, go him, pray him, study him. And look him you behind. It's quite an interesting language. And so I sort of like learning languages. I spoke a little bit of their language, and they were even more happy. But you can see the charts and the rain, and we were getting soaking wet, all sopped down. We didn't have umbrellas. But anyway, God was opening the doors to spread the gospel and plant the gospel seed. Some falls on good ground. Some falls on stony ground. Some on thorny ground. All different grounds, but the Word of God is the seed. And then these different churches all through Papua New Guinea, little flocks here and there, altogether a couple thousand Godhead believers there. So when you pray 3 times a day like Daniel, evening, morning, and noon, and bow on your knees, and like it says in Hebrews, wherefore lift up the hands that hang down. When you pray and remember Papua New Guinea, and God's work also in China. They go around barefoot and sit on grass, in grass huts and grass floors there. But this was a place, look at the smiles on their face. This is called Michael Mountain. And if you go on the YouTube sometime later on, plug in there. It's something, I don't know if you can do a proximity thing on Google. But anyway, if you plug in something like Kuru, K-U-R-U, and then also sorcery. It'll plug up a little, about a 30-minute thing about these people in this area 50 years ago, not 500 years ago like Martin Luther's time, but only 50 years ago, they were still eating people. Now they're eating the bread of life and eating the, like Jesus said, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. And these people 50 years ago in this area were eating the brains of people, smart people. They would like to eat their brains to get their wisdom or whatever. And anyway, we don't have time to go through all this, but this in the Philippines, God is working. This is a school up in the mountains. the little health restoration country site. Dave will recognize a lot of these people and places, and they're building a little school to make for training young people to be evangelists and teachers and preachers, and they don't have electricity up here, so they do everything by just a candlelight. And do they have a generator there? I think they do.
They don't really use it. They have a small solar panel that they
connect
their phones with, but the power company is actually putting power in at the present time.
Okay, they're trying to get power. They make bread up there. Jesus said, man doesn't live by bread alone. There's a little picture of some of the folks there. And they have a nice place for baptism. When we were there, a big typhoon came through. You can see the trees fell down on the buildings. It was a gigantic typhoon that came through. Then this is a mountain that one of the Godhead brothers lives right at the bottom. We spent time there, and the mountain is always smoking like this. And remember, Patriarchs and Prophets says how that in the last days there'll be earthquakes and volcanoes because the lime ore and the coal and oil make up. And then she says they're going to be, these earthquakes and volcanoes are going to be more frequent and more disastrous the closer and closer we get to the end. And there's been so many earthquakes, these things happening recently. We went to a church. You can see this is another chart I set up there, and I told them, I said, now would you like to hear smooth things today, or would you like to hear the Word of God? How many of you want to hear smooth things? And nobody raised their hand. How many of you want to hear the Word of God? Okay. So afterwards, please don't throw tomatoes at me or eggs. You said you wanted to hear not smooth things. So we went through and we agitated a little bit here. This was the whole church there, and passed out DVDs and things. And you can see this is another brother, Chris. He said most of the founders of the Seventh-day Adventism would not be able to join that church today if they had to subscribe to the denomination's fundamental beliefs. So we went over the things about the Trinity. This was doing some street preaching up in a park. This was the very day they had a big earthquake in Philippines. So when there's an earthquake, that's a wonderful time to begin to do street preaching, because people are seeing, yeah, the signs of the times are coming. And we preached there in the evening. It was beautiful sunset, and we went all the way until evening time. You can see it's dark here now. There was about 60 students. A couple of them stayed by and took a picture. But God is opening doors for evangelism all around the world. This was in another part of the Philippines, and having little meetings in huts, setting up our charts, and at a bus stop and giving some lectures. Another place in the marketplace. And God is just opening doors here and there for the preaching of the gospel. And, you know, the Lord says, be not afraid, but speak. Hold not thy peace, because I am with you, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, because I have much people in this city. Amen. God has his people in all these cities and places, and he wants to share. Here's this actual chart. You see the same Mother of Harlots up there. We put that up and get people's attention, and then they gather around. This was in front of a big Catholic mass on Sunday afternoon in Cebu, and the policeman came and said, we saw the policeman coming, and I thought, uh-oh, now we're done. We got to finish. But the policeman was very kind and courteous. He said, no, just move from here and move over to there. So we used to be right about in here, right at the gate, so we moved over to here. You can see it's not really dark yet, but we went on, and it's getting dark, and we went through, and people came. It was mass, and on Sunday they have mass continually. So people come and go, and then they'd go in here and take their mass, and then come out and hear about the Mother of Harlots and the Mark of the Beast and changing times and laws. And we had really interesting contacts and different parts of the Philippines. Then in Taiwan, opening doors, sharing there in Taiwan. And this was at the Seventh-day Adventist College in Taiwan. They asked us to come and speak. So we spoke to about 400 students there, the whole filled with young students, and then met some other Chinese
teacher
at that college.
Taiwan.
You know his name?
Look it up.
Okay. I met this old, nice, Confucius-looking Chinese grandpa, and we had a nice talk together. And then preaching on the trains, and this was in Japan, and
preaching in the dark.
Preaching in the darkness. Gross darkness has covered. They're supposed to. Darkness has covered the earth, and gross darkness the people. Okay, this is not working here. There was like a little 30-second video clip, but it doesn't want to. Oh, here we go. Yeah, you can see. Can't see it too well or hear too well, but this was those other pictures. And they would come and listen, not for 10 minutes or 30, 40 minutes like we are here today. They were there for hours and hours. And
did Chris do
anything? Chris asked questions. In question time, he did. He didn't know. I told him to go do it, but he got a little weak-kneed. But the children and everyone comes around and listens. So God is opening the doors here and there. And I want to ask all of you to pray that God will continue to open doors. And you can find ways yourself. You don't have to go out and preach. But, you know, in America, I think we want to do this program. This is a wonderful way to do it. And just in finishing here, let me tell you how you do it. You go to some park anywhere where there's some people. And then you can maybe get a chart like this, or even if you don't have a chart, and let's say Terry is going to be speaking, okay? Terry is going to stand up here and speak, and then Dorothy and Elvis and Morgan and Dave and Mike and Sister Ann, however many in your group, you will be watching from a distance. And when Terry stands up and begins to speak, then two of you from this way, two of you from that way, come and gather around and sort of pretend like you don't know him. You really do know him, right? But you sort of just come and listen. And when there's a little group, you stand and gingerly listen as he's speaking. And then as there's a little group gathering around, then other people will come out of curiosity. And pretty soon you'll have a big crowd and talk about things about health or the gospel, whatever. God will give you the words. And then throw it open for question time. Any of you have any questions? Comments, whatever. And then Elvis would ask a question. And we have some planned out questions ahead of time. And then Elvis would ask the question, we'd answer. And then I'd say, is there any other questions? And wait a few minutes. By this time, there's many other people that are not amongst our little core group. And if nobody asks a question, then I'd cough a bit or scratch my head. And that would be a clue for Mike to ask a question or Thomas to ask a question or Raquel to ask a question. And then you get two or three questions from us. It usually takes two or three from our own group. And then pretty soon other people will start asking questions. And then somebody amongst the group is handing out tracts to everybody, getting phone numbers. And I did that once in Korea, and it started pouring down rain. A total stranger came and put an umbrella up and standing right next to me with an umbrella. And then the pastor, Pastor Jungwon Hang, I remember I just saw him a couple months ago in Taiwan. Three people were baptized through that. He started studying with them, had Bible studies, and they were baptized later on. And so that's the way Jesus did. When Jesus spoke, how many men were there? 5,000 men, not including the women and the children with the 5 barley loaves and the 2 fish. But the book Mount of Blessings says that Jesus sat down on the mountain and the disciples sat in front of him, the 12. And then pretty soon people started coming. And so when you do this, Terry, next Sunday, you got to get a little group of people with you to start with, and then other people will come. If you try to do it by yourself, I first learned about this and I did it by myself and nobody came. You stand there like a fool, the foolishness of preaching. But you got to have a little group, and then you could even invite them up. I say, I have a friend and his name's Dave. And then Dave would come up and give a little testimony. Or I have another friend, Andy. And now Andy will come up and give it, and not some theological dissertation, but some personal little testimony. And it's a training for the people and then branching out into new people. And it's really exciting. Then you get prayer, subjects for prayer. When you go home and pray that night, you really got something to pray about. Amen. This guy here and that guy. And when you look in their eyes as you're talking, you can see some are getting convicted. And some are listening. Some hang and listen from the beginning to end. Some will listen for a while and then go and then come back again later. And there's all kinds of, but the angels are, I think, can you imagine let's just imagine in 1 minute in closing here, if we are angels, if you're an angel and you got nominated or what's the word?
Promoted.
Not promoted, but commissioned, that's the word. The God says to this angel, now I want you to protect and guide and lead this brother or that sister. And then if God commissioned the angels to the most lukewarm Laodicean that there is, don't you think that angel would be just sort of bored? But angels are eager to work with us if we'll just step out on the boat like Peter on the water and find some way to get out. Do call portering, door to door, whatever. Angels want to just open doors and lead and guide and lead us. But we have to cooperate. So without me, you can do nothing. But with God, we can do all things. So I want to just encourage all of you to, when you pray, to remember some of these places like China, Taiwan, and Philippines, and other places, even here in America. God wants to open doors. So the Bible says, I think 73 times, fear not. You can even think of some Bible verses that has fear not in it, right? Fear not, I am with thee. Be not afraid, I am thy God. All these commands to fear not. So why don't we have a prayer together as we close. Father in heaven, as you're the King of Kings, we thank you for the marriage that you've prepared for your Son, your only begotten Son, and that you've invited us, whether we're good or bad, but we all know that we're as bad can be. But we thank you for that invitation, and Lord, that now as you're coming in to see the guests, Lord, we want to learn how to wear that wedding garment. Teach us how to be clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness day by day, and seek the Lord and be converted every day, and of our own free choice to take the yoke, to take the invitation, come unto me. And Lord, we pray for your work in the Philippines, in China, in Taiwan, and all around every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, that you'll use us to be fishers of men. This is our first work, Lord. Our other work is whatever it may be, but we want to be successful fishers of men, so we pray that you will give us wisdom. Now, a few more hours before the Sabbath, help us as we prepare for this high Sabbath that's coming. Thank you for all the blessings of this camp meeting, and we're looking forward to your rich blessings. And we claim the promise, Father, that even though we're bad and evil, that you promised to give us your Spirit. Thank you for giving us your Spirit, and we praise you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.